Raffaele.
Ok. Microfono sono questi due.
Sì, quindi.
Magari vai in sì. Scherziamo.
Questo va enter full screen e basta se ci sono. View. Enter full screen. Shit. Merda, come mai? View. Facciamo così, Command F. Ecco. Vado te. E non ci sono riuscito a arrivare, ci ho provato.
Ok. Ok. Great.
Ok. Thank you. I'm happy to have been here, of course. You can see my affiliation. Actually, I have an office two floors off, up. But given the mandatory retirement age not of Europe, I'm no longer, this is my main institution now. I wanted to comment on chemistry, what we said before. Many, many, almost all useful concepts in chemistry don't have a first principle definition, like unicity, covalency, aromaticity, whatever. Unicity, for instance, hopefully all unicity scales are monotonic also, but there are many, many different scales of unicity. Okay, now what is this about? I will take up many, many things. I will just jump on what I'm happy that his presentation by Nicola was very good because I will speak of many, many things he has already introduced very, very well. Now, this is the I will start with the main concept about polarization. As you have learned right now, position operator is not defined if you adopt periodic boundary condition. It is not an operator. It maps a function which fulfills periodic boundary condition, bound for Karman, periodic boundary condition into some function which does not. And that was really the main bottleneck which hindered the development of polarization theory. While, of course, in a molecule there is no problem, because if you adopt what is usually called the open boundary condition, that is, you use a square integrable wave function, position is a very simple elementary multiplicative operator. Now, the change of paradigm occurred exactly 30 years ago, about by the day, because there was a workshop in the United States, and David Vanderbilt and his student or postdoc Dominic Smith had a poster. I was there, I looked at the poster, and that was really the ultimate solution of the polarization problem, at least in a band insulator, at least at the independent particle level. Now, nowadays, the polarization is routinely computed according to the modern theory, but modern in quotes, because some time ago a referee told me, why do you call it still modern? It is not modern anymore. It is 30 years, so that's okay. By now, it is implemented in most codes, you may know, but very few textbooks have taken notice of the paradigm. And to look back at some textbooks, this is the Feynman lecture of physics. It says a complex crystal lattice can have a permanent intrinsic polarization. The book suggests that it is the dipole of the cell. But of course, you also have learned that the choice of the cell is completely arbitrary. So if you choose this cell, you find this dipole. If you choose this cell, you find the opposite dipole. And then you may ask, which dipole is the right one? Neither one is the good. Polarization is something else. Other books are the Kittel, says a ferroelectric crystal exhibits an electric dipole moment even in the absence of an electric field. And in a ferroelectric state, the center of positive charge does not coincide with the center of negative charge. But it is clear that the center of positive charge and the center of negative charge from the previous slide is ill-defined if you use periodic boundary condition, of course. If you cut the system in some way with some surface, of course it is. But otherwise, if you use periodic boundary condition, that means you wrap this side on this side, you get... What are this? Okay. Now, the Ashcroft-Mermin. Cosa succede?
Okay, no, it's fine.
Now, the Astro Memory says the crystal whose natural primitive cell have a vanishing dipole moment are called pyroelectric, but it's clear also there is no such thing as a natural primitive cell, as I've shown also earlier. So in the obsolete textbook, the focus is invariably on the charge density of periodic solid. And instead, slowly, let's say by the end of the 80s, early 90s, we came to the idea that the charge density is not all, that there must be something else. And in fact, the density obtained from the square modulus of the Kohn-Sham block orbitals, and after the so-called modern theory was established, it is pretty clear that instead the only entries for the polarization theory are the phase factor of the Kohn-Sham orbitals as a function of k, more precisely of the u orbitals as a function of k. An alternative formulation yields the polarization in terms of the charge density of the Wannier function. So I will start adopting this alternative formulation, of course, because it is a school on Wannier function, but also because here it is very, very intuitive. Now, one important point is that polarization is well defined only if you have a charge neutral system, exactly like the dipole of a molecule. Only if the molecule is neutral, you have a dipole which is uniquely defined. It does not depend where you set the origin or coordinate space. Now, suppose that you have a nuclei of charge EZL at some sites in a given unit cell. You choose a given unit cell, and then the nuclear, you can write the nuclear term in the polarization just as the dipole of the cell, as here. But of course, this is arbitrary modulo. Since I say a given unit cell, a given, what happens here? What happens? Why I've lost that? I've done something with this wonderful engine. I've done something wrong.
Interesting.
Okay. Now, if I said a given unit cell, and in fact, the problem is that you might choose a different cell. If you choose a different cell, you find a different quantum, a different polarization, which differs by the previous one, by this factor, which usually is called the quantum of polarization. Next, if you write in terms of Wannier function, then you need the electronic term. The electronic term is very simple, as shown by Nicola earlier. You take Wannier function in a given cell, which we call the central cell. You define the Wannier centers, and then the electronic term has a very, very simple expression. It's just the dipole of the given cell times two, because they are twice occupied. And here again, it is arbitrary modulo the quantum, and it is also arbitrary modulo what I call the Marzari-Van der Waals-Bahn transformation, that is just the capital U of K matrix, which was shown before. So no matter how you mix the occupied bands, you always get the same quantity, again, modulo the quantum. So this is the polarization theory. And you may ask, for an unbounded periodic solid, the total polarization is the sum, as it must be, of the nuclear term and the electronic term, defined modulo the quantum, and invariant by translation of the origin. Now, if you have a bounded sample, and in very large bounded sample, a macroscopic bounded sample, then you may ask, polarization there is not a multivalued observable. It has a well precise value, and this is fixed by nature. By nature, because nature wants to minimize the energy. So depending of what you attach at the end of the solid, you may have a different value of the quantum. Instead, if you are doing the theory with periodic boundary condition, either block states or Wannier function, you are by definition an unbounded solid without any surface. So insofar as you want to deal with a solid which is infinite, periodic, fulfills all of the space and with block states and the like, you are not allowed to fix that quantum. The quantum must remain there. It is intrinsic in the observable. We had many, even recently, we had some objections by knowledge of colleagues, and we discussed it with them. It is multivalued, but it is uniquely defined. It is uniquely defined provided you use a primitive set, because of course, if you take a supercell, the quantum looks like different. But if you go back to Kittel, Kittel tells you that the lattice is an abstraction. In some sense, whenever a material is by definition is crystalline, by definition you may attach a concept which is a lattice, which is an abstraction. You may have quantum nuclei, finite temperature, solid alloys, chemical mix, and the like. Whenever you have this abstraction, there is a uniquely defined minimum volume of the cell. So you have to use the cell which has the minimum volume. In this way, it is sure that you have a multivalued but uniquely defined observable. I tend to insist because this is a message which does not pass easily even with two knowledgeable colleagues. David knows pretty well. I've seen it was a little smiling. Now, a simple example. Let's take alternating polyacetylene. Here in one dimension, the polarization is a dipole per unit length. That means as the dimensions are pure charge. So the quantum equals the unit charge. We focus only on the pi electrons. There are two pi electrons per cell, so there is only one band, which is doubly occupied. There is only one relevant Bonnier function, which sits at the center of the double bond. And it is a very simple exercise to prove that in this particular one-dimensional system, the polarization must be zero modulo one, unit of charge. And you may ask, is this an artifact or is this something which occurs in nature? What happens if I have an abundant sample? So we made a pedagogical simulation several years ago with Roberto Carr and a postdoc in Princeton, Kostia Kudin. As an example, we took two polyacetylene chains. We terminated them in a different way. And both terminations were polar. So the molecule has a dipole. Both molecules must have a dipole because they are asymmetric. And we computed just without using any periphase, any Bonnier function, just using the Gaussian code, which is the reference code for quantum chemistry, we calculated the dipole of this as a function of the number of monomers. And the result is shown here in the bottom figure. That you see that insofar as the chain is very short, both have a dipole which is non-zero, but as the chain becomes longer and longer, you get that they converge to a value. This is dipole per monomer. If you divide by the cell, by the cell A, you find just zero or one. So these are two possible manifestations. In the periodic system, you have zero modulo one, and you can find a bounded system where it is zero, another bounded system, which is one. For a three-dimensional system, there are complications which I prefer not to speak here. It is the fact that if you have a bounded sample, you have depolarizing fields, while the theory, it was almost implicit that the polarization theory only holds for zero electric fields. So when you have a function, you have a zero macroscopic field. And bounded samples, which are spontaneously polarized in particular, if ferroelectric material has a depolarizing field. So there are complications. But the one-dimensional system is free from those complications. That's the reason why we have chosen a one-dimensional system. Now, in order to go on, we were speaking of periphases and the like, I want to introduce quantum geometry. What is quantum geometry? The geometry, you have to define a distance to make geometry, and I define the distance in this way. Two state vectors, which belong to the same Hilbert space, have a distance which is minus the logarithm of the scalar product to the square. This is clearly gauge invariant, of course, and is zero if the two states coincide apart for a phase. The states are normalized, of course, and it is infinite if the states are orthogonal. If you go back to the definitions and to axioms of a distance in the calculus book, this is not really completely kosher. There is an axiom which is not fulfilled, but it is not a problem. I think it is better to use in this way. And then, and so this is the distance. Now, the distance, you can, it is an identity, you can, the logarithm of the square is equal, of the square modulus is equal to the logarithm of the scalar product times the complex conjugate, the logarithm of the complex conjugate. Each of the two terms is not Gaijin invariant. Each of the two terms may have an imaginary part. The real part gives you the distance, but the imaginary part, what is the meaning of the imaginary part? The meaning of the imaginary part is very simple. If you write the scalar product as the modulus of the scalar product times a phase factor, the imaginary part is just the phase. And so this is the key quantity in what comes on, because the connection fixes the phase difference between the two. It is clearly arbitrary. You can choose, you know pretty well that you can choose an arbitrary phase factor for psi 1, another arbitrary phase factor for psi 2, so this cannot have any physical meaning. And now you can say, given that it is arbitrary, why do you bother about this phase? And in fact, nobody bothered until the early 80s, when Michael Berry came out and said, phases are not so irrelevant, even if individually they are gauge dependent, they can be used, must be used, to build quantities which are gauge invariant and therefore are measurable. So in this famous, if I have, at that time he knew only a couple of phenomena which had the characteristic of what we nowadays we call a Berry phase. That was the Aronov-Bohm experiment, and that was the conical intersection in molecule. There was nothing else. But after that, for many years, Berry phases came out in every field of physics, including our one, electronic structure and polarization. If I have to summarize the main message of this paper is that, first of all, we have learned since we were very young that in order to have a measurable quantity, you need an operator. You have to invent an operator such that the observable is the expectation value or the eigenvalue of the operator. And the paper by Berry says there are observables which are not related to any operator. They are just gauge invariant phases of the wave function, so completely revolutionary kinds of observables. And the second message is whenever in quantum mechanics you may write a gauge invariant quantity, this quantity is in principle something which is measurable. And I will come back to this at the very end of this talk. That's just to anticipate. So whenever you have a gauge invariant quantity in quantum mechanics, in principle this can be measured. Now, if we want to do geometry in the block states, with block states, clearly you cannot do with the psi k, because psi k are different k, are orthogonal. In a sense, they are not in the same Hilbert space, and that you do instead in the U. The U are in the same Hilbert space, the U function are all periodic, all obey the periodic condition on the cell, not on the other. So that is, they have a finite distance. And by definition, the matrix is the infinitesimal distance, the infinitesimal distance between k and delta k. And the quantum, if you take the two derivatives of what is up there, of the logarithm, then you find what is in the bottom line. That is, I've done something wrong. I didn't want to do that. I don't know. Okay, I will not use the pointer. That's fine. I don't need the pointer. So in the last line, you have the quantum metric tensor for one band, which is the infinitesimal distance in k-space. And it is gauge invariant. This is it's not clear from the expression, but you can prove it is gauge invariant. Then you have also the phase, of course. And each of these two terms I told are not gauge invariant. The infinitesimal phase difference is by definition the connection. So the infinitesimal phase distance between the U states at K and K plus delta K is linear in delta K. You need the first derivative. And A is what is called the Berry connection. The Berry connection is gauge dependent because you can have an arbitrary phase factor in the U which contributes to the derivative. It is a real vector field because the scalar product, product is purely imaginary, so you have an I in front in order to make it real. And if you take the curl of this Berry curvature, you get something which is gauge invariant, which sometimes is written in three dimension, can be written also as a pseudo-vector, of course, as a pseudo-vector, but or you can write as an anti-symmetric matrix, a pseudo-scalar in two dimension, a pseudo-vector in three dimension. If you want to go beyond, it is an anti-symmetric matrix. Now, if you have many bands, the Berry connection is that the sum on the occupied bands, of course, you are dealing with an insulator, so the number of states is the same at all different case. And you can define a metric curvature tensor of the occupied manifold such that the quantum metric is just a real part of this tensor, and the Berry curvature is just the imaginary part, a part for a factor minus two. At the end of this talk, I will also address very briefly metals. And so in metals, I take the curvature of the occupied manifold, just summing on the occupied state with a Fermi function, which cuts the states. Now, Berry phase, the famous theory. This is the very, very famous formula by Vanderbilt and King-Smith, which came out, as I told, published in 93, but shown the first time to the world in a poster in May 92. And it is equivalent to the Bonnier function. This has been shown by Nicola. That was already known since 1962. So the equivalence between this formula of course, 62, Berry phase was not existing yet. Berry phase came 20 years afterwards. Nobody called that integral a Berry phase, of course, but by now we recognize, actually, Joshua Zak recognized that it is a Berry phase in 89. And so the transformation was known since the 1960s. What was not known was the physical meaning of all of this, because one year function were a very formal topic used just for demonstrating theorems. And in fact, I would say the Marzari-Vanderbilt paper have shown that any functions are not just a formal topic, as a very useful practical topics. That I think this is also what changed with electronic structure in the late 90s. So the equivalence was known. This is the formula, and it's just the Brillouin zone integral or even the reciprocal cell integral of the Berry connection. The periodic gauge is mandatory. So you have arbitrary, as Nicola showed, you have an arbitrariness in choosing the phase of different block states at different k's. You need to choose the same phase whenever you translate k by a reciprocal vector. That means that the u the translated U needs a plane wave, of course. So in this way, you have a closed loop in reciprocal space, and so the integral is actually the integral over a closed path. The figure was drawn by David in one of the few papers, very few papers we wrote together, so one of the few papers co-authored by David and me, and I've drawn, this picture was drawn by him and came out from there. Now, the key features of this is this is invariant by translation of the coordinate origin. Both terms, of course, depend on the origin, both the electronic and the nuclear, but not the sum of the two. This is gauge invariant modulo the quantum, as I've shown before. This is gauge invariant by the U Marzari-Vanderbilt transformation. The choice of the branch, now you have a multivalued observable. If you want to use this, as usually is done, to evaluate Born effective charges or piezoelectricity, the choice of the branch is obvious. You have to choose the same. Even for spontaneous polarization, is a little bit more delicate, but it's not a problem. So this is used in that way. Now, suppose I have a cubic lattice in three dimensions. You have only one band. The integral on the reciprocal cell is this triple integral. But where is the Berry phase? The Berry phase is the inner integral. The inner integral, the red one, is a gamma. For any fixed ky, kz, you have the integral of a one-dimensional Berry connection. And now the problem is how to discretize, because when you
solve, find the ground state by numerical diagonalization. You have a diagonalization routine which gives you the eigenstate, gives you the U. And the U, they are not differentiable. So the U at the different K have a completely random phase, a completely random phase. So you cannot do a numerical derivative as you would do in the standard way. In other words, the integral in KY, in KZ, is rather trivial. You take a mesh and the like. But the integral in KX, that integral in KX is done on a function which is which has an erratic phase, so it's not differentiable. You cannot resolve by finite difference. And the solution is like this. We have to compute the integral of the Berry connection of a closed loop. And then you have to remember that, as I've shown before, the Berry connection is the infinitesimal phase difference. But we had the formula for what was the finite phase difference, was just minus the imaginary part of the logarithm. If delta k is along the x direction. And now we discretize with endpoints at constant ky and kz, and you have to compute the integral of each of those lines. The integral of those lines is computed using the discretization shown there. That means sum of the logarithm is equal to the logarithm product. And now it is clear that the erratic phase factors are irrelevant if you remember that the last factor there, actually, you don't need to diagonalize in n plus 1 points. In this way, you say you have k0, k1, k2, up to kn, that would be n plus 1 points. But you want a closed loop. You want to diagonalize only on n points. And in fact, the last one must use the periodic gauge condition. So if you do with periodic gauge condition. And now this is pretty clear that whenever you have, even if the guy who coded the diagonalization routine has inserted a random number generator and gives you, by construction, a random phase factor, completely random, the random phase factor cancel out the in the bra and the ket. Each bra is compensated by a counterpart in a ket, and this goes away. So the most erratic factor you can imagine are irrelevant, harmless for this kind of formula. If you have many bands, you have a n by n connection matrix, the number of occupied bands, and the formula is minus the imaginary part of the logarithm of the product of these matrices. Even in this case, it is clear that since the determinant of a matrix is invariant by any unitary transformation, here again, the Mazzari-Vanderbilt capital U matrix doesn't make any harm, and you have something which is very, very well defined. And this is the way, actually, how it is implemented in many, many density functional codes. So this is the way the polarization theory works practically in all of the codes which have it. There is a rather delicate point how to choose the quantum when you are on different lines, when you have on different lines a different, on different Y and Z, I would say. Okay. Now, other geometrical observables. Now, after we understand that, polarization, I think, is all I wanted to say. The first one is since both of these observables have to do with conductivity, I have to say one slide for fundamentals about conductivity. Linear conductivity is a tensor, of course, is a tensor which gives you the current as a function of the electric field. It has a symmetric part and an antisymmetric part. The antisymmetric part gives rise to a current which is always orthogonal to the field, so it is a whole current or a transverse current. The other one is longitudinal. So even, if the material is anisotropic, the current will not be proportional to the field, but of course, since a symmetric tensor can always be diagonalized, there are at least three principal directions where the current is in the same direction as the field. Now, transverse conductivity requires breaking of time reversal symmetry, so for instance, a ferroelectric material or a macroscopic external field. Matroscopic and central field is a problem for band structure theory. I will say a word at the end. In general, so we only speak of the so-called anomalous Hall effect. That means anomalous is something which happens because material by itself breaks time reversal symmetry, for instance, because of ferromagnetism. If you have a pristine metal, the electrons undergo free acceleration. So if you have the Ohm law is only due to extrinsic effect. If you imagine a solid without any extrinsic effect, then the system responds only at frequency omega equals zero. There are no other response. So the conductivity is a delta at omega equals zero, the real part. You have a real and an imaginary part because of the Kramer-Kronig some rule. Because of causality, whenever you have a real part, you also need an imaginary part, and what you see there in square parentheses. So in this formula, you see that the real part has a delta at omega and then has a regular pair. The delta is the fingerprint of free acceleration, and the coefficient in front, called the Drude weight, tells you the inverse inertia of the many electron system. It typically is a density over a mass. For free electrons, it's simply the density over the mass. And otherwise, you can think of it as an effective density over mass ratio for a given metal. So in a given metal, you always have an acceleration. If we deal with insulator for the time being. In insulator, the Drude weight is zero, and also the conductivity is gapped. That means it's zero until omega reaches the main gap. And now back to the Sousa-Wilkins-Martin sum rule. This was in the thesis, PhD thesis of Ivo Sousa, who is here, and Martin was Richard Martin was the supervisor. Let's go back to omega I. Omega I has been shown by Nicola what it is. It is a lower bound for it is gauge invariant, as I said, but it's not in general it's not a minimum, except in one dimension. In a two-dimensional, three-dimensional system, in general it's not a minimum, it's a lower bound, but it is gauge invariant, does not depend on the capital U matrix. And now going back to the very main message. Whenever you have something, gauge invariant is measurable. And the question is, can you ideally measure omega I? How can you measure? Which kind of experiment do you have to perform ideally to measure omega I? Omega I is a ground state property, clearly. It cannot be measured by probing the ground state itself, but it can be measured with some rule for the conductivity. So Sousa, Wilkins, and Martin in 2000, the year 2000, proposed this integral just as a discriminant between insulators and metals, all insulators and all metals, not only mean field or Konsham, I would say, insulators and metals, but also correlated metals, disordered metals. Whenever you have something which is insulating or metallic, this integral is either divergent or finite. In the band case, in the special band case, it is clear that in a metal this is divergent because you have a delta of omega over omega, and this clearly is something which badly diverges. Instead, if you have a band insulator, as I said before, the conductivity is zero until the gap. The integral is no longer from zero to infinity, but it is from the gap to infinity, and you have this this integral. And now you see the relationship. So ideally, if you want to measure omega I is not an intensive quantity. You get an intensive quantity by divided by the volume of the cell, and this is just a part of a trivial constant. Is just equal to the Sousa, Wilkins, and Martin integral. Next, the next thing is anomalous Hall conductivity. Anomalous Hall conductivity, as I said, is something which only occurs in time reversal breaking materials. Anomalous Hall conductivity has to do with the Berry curvature. So let's write again the Berry curvature of the occupied manifold. for a metal or for an insulator. This covers the two cases. This is a function which is smooth in insulators and is piecewise continuous in metals. What is clear that I can also always find a smooth gauge, always kind of smooth gauge for, in this sense. In the topological case, there are subtleties about the smooth gauge, but not for this quantity, of course. And now, from the Kubo formula, you write conductivity as always. You find it through a linear response theory to Kubo formula, but the Kubo formula can be transformed into a ground state property. Actually, this transformation of the Kubo formula into a ground state property is the great result of Taules, Komoto, TKNN, Taules, Komoto, Denise, Nightingale and Denise, Nobel Prize for Taules in 2016. So it's what gives you the quantization, but the formula is the same. The formula is the same. It was discovered only in the, despite the work by Taules dates since 1982, the fact that even in metals there is such a contribution came out only in the early 2000s. Now, the formula at the end, from Kubo formula and doing the transformation pioneered by Taules, you may write the Kubo formula for the DC transverse conductivity in both insulators and metals in either two dimension or three dimension in the way I've written there. And for a two-dimensional case is a very special case because you can notice that there is an H bar in the first formula, there is only H in the second formula. And you have in an insulator, what is in red is 1 over 2 pi times a dimensionless integral. The curvature has a dimension of the squared length, so you have 1 over 2 pi times a dimensional integral. This is an integer. This is called the Chern number, so the Chern theorem in the 40s, well before this was useful in physics, mathematicians have dealt with those quantities and got a very interesting result. That means, and this shows that the conductivity is quantized, and transverse resistivity, of course, is also quantized, and by now, H over E square is a standard of resistance, universal standard of resistance. The inverse of what is there is called a 1 Clizzi. So 1 Clizzi. So the conductivity is just an inverse Clizzi times an integer. Let's go to the what happens in metals, insulators, and other. In ferroelectric metals, ferromagnetic metals, this was discovered already by Hall himself. So Hall discovered 1 year or 2 years earlier the regular Hall effect, and then discovered the anomalous Hall effect in materials which break time reversal symmetry spontaneously instead in it. The theory has been very, very controversial until the early 2000, as I said. There are for sure extrinsic contributions, like called in different ways. There are two difficult to separate experimentally, but they exist, the two different contributions, Q, Scattering, Sejan. But it was universally recognized, as I said, about 20 years ago, there is an intrinsic geometrical contribution, which is exactly the same as for the quantum Hall effect, except it is not quantized. If you instead want what is now called quantum anomalous Hall effect in two-dimensional time reversal breaking insulators, the theory came in 1988 in a very, very important paper by Duncan Aldane, who also got the Nobel Prize in 2016 for this work and also for another important work, I would say. But it was very, very difficult to synthesize materials who may have this, where you may see this quantization. This was finally achieved in 2013 in China, and then a couple of years afterwards in California, and there is a very, very good correlation. In this case, of course, contrary to the metallic case, there are no intrinsic contribution. That is, a basic tenet of topology is that whenever you have some property which is topological, then you can do, this is very robust, you can do whatever you want to the system. The conductivity cannot change insofar as the system remains insulator. So only if the system passes through a metallic state, then you can switch Chern number. So you, suppose you have a material where the Chern number is 1, the conductivity remains 1, even in disordered case, even whatever you do, except when material becomes metallic. Instead, as I said before, in time reversal breaking metal, you must have extrinsic contribution, because of course you would not otherwise have Ohm's law. Since Ohm's law is a fact of experimental fact of life, that means that the impurities must also contribute to the transverse. And finally, going back to the experiment, famous experiment by von Klitzing, Dord, and Pepper, the theory came out by TK and N, as I said before, but in this case, K cannot be a block vector for a very good reason. Whenever you have a macroscopic field, there is no way of writing a vector potential which gives you a periodic Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian is non-periodic. You have to do something else. There are very exotic things, like the density of states changes abruptly. The problem is non-analytic at B equals 0. You have Landau levels, so everything is very delicate. But in this respect, the fact that you need the real reason why you have block states actually is translational invariance of the Hamiltonian. You may find a more complex symmetry, which is a magnetic translation. You translate and you do something else, and so all of the algebra goes in the same way, and so you have the same thing. Next, I show only some reference. So the main reference for what I've been saying here in the first talk, and this one I would say is the book by David Vanderbilt, which came out 2018, I guess, or 4 years ago by now. And also there are my lecture notes, which you find online. Online, the address is a bit complicated, but if you Google Raffaele Resta, you find either me or a woman hairdresser in Rome. And it's easy to choose, and you find those notes. And with that, I thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Raffaele, for the very nice talk. So we are a little bit late on schedule, but I think there is definitely time for 1-2 questions. Sure.
So thank you for the talk, first of all. I was just wondering, how do these representations of polarization, so as a Berry phase or as a Vanier function, how do they differ, if at all, from the Dyson equation representation of polarization, for example, in the Eden's equations?
That's a Dyson equation. Now, it depends. Dyson equation is not Hermitian, in a sense. So if you think about the GW representation, then in that case, I would say there is no problem in that, because they make a very, very big simplification. So the important point is the one body density matrix the one body density matrix is a projector in our business, and it is not if you really want to do Dyson equation, but in the GW, the approximation is that in general is a projector, so let's say the Dyson orbitals are not orthonormal in general, the true ones, but within GW you approximate with orthonormal. So in that case, can be done. So the GW polarization can be done. Instead, I take this occasion for telling you something which I forgot saying, maybe good to know. If the Chern number is non-zero, in that case, you cannot have a periodic gauge, and you don't have any functions. So the polarization in a topological non-trivial material where Schoenhammer number non-zero is a tricky business. Something can be done. There is a very pretty paper by, always again, by David and a co-worker, but it's, the theory as it is cannot work if the Schoenhammer number is non-zero.
Thank you.
Okay, so are there any other questions? Oh.
Thanks, thanks, Raffaele. Maybe just a little bit of a wild one. Since at the end, you know, electric fields and magnetic fields are a quadrivector in a fully relativistic treatment, all mixed together, shouldn't there be, you know, a fully relativistic sort of expression for all these quantities? And
because there is a profound mathematical difference. That is, the polarization came from the one form, there is only one derivative or one differential or whatever, and the conductivity and magnetization also came from a two form. And this is enormous difference. In fact, you can write all of the observables coming from a two form, like transverse conductivity or magnetization, in terms of the ground state projector. You cannot write polarization in terms of the ground state projector. The only way would be to diagonalize the ground state projector and then compute the Berry phase.
Thanks. Thanks.
Any questions on Zoom? Please raise your hand or write something in the chat. Yeah, there is one. Okay, question, why we can use the Berry phase polarization to compute the electric constant, or can we do it?
No, this was, I think I've showed that there was already in my slide, in fact, cannot, not in its original form. There is a variant, which is also due to a couple of papers, one of them by Ivo Sousa and David Vanderbilt, but not with the standard because, as I've seen, as I said somewhere here, in any case, whenever you have an electric field, you don't have block states, you don't have Wanier function in their standard form. So you can compute derivatives of polarization by numerical differentiation. You can take with any perturbation like piezoelectricity, ferroelectricity, or Born effective charges, even pyroelectricity, things like that, but not the electric field. This is the only one because what is implicit in all of this theory in its standard form is that the field is zero.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, I think we can thank Raffaele again. Okay.